So we have last first discussed till there, right? Training our model. Okay. So in today's class, we will be seeing some overview of how a simple machine learning model is created. Okay. In just in today's class, and then in some further upcoming videos, we will be dealing with some complex code. Like in there, we will be just seeing cleaning data. And you will find it interesting that to see that in just in cleaning data you have whole lot of things to do. In just scaling you have to do lot many things, right? But when we are working, but for today we will be doing all those things, and we will take a easy, very easy example like your house price prediction. We will try to predict what should be the cost of your price based on the some criteria, based upon some features. Okay. So in today's video, it will be simple. We will be going through the all whole this workflow in today in one video. Okay? And in the upcoming video, in the upcoming lectures, sorry, we will be seeing each step with our detail. Okay, like cleaning data, you will see how you actually take a real world scenario, right? And you perform some insights on that. Okay, so today. Yes. So, any doubt or confusion till here, like hyperparameter? Yes.
No, I'm okay.
This hyperparameter loss function model training data set. Okay. So we have seen the types of machine learning: supervised, unsupervised, reinforcement. Okay. And in key components, we have seen some terminologies like features. What are the features in machine learning labels? Training data set. Training data set is your test data set. And after that, we have seen what the model is. After that, we have seen loss functions. Okay, like loss function is basically comparing your predicted output to your true output. Okay, and our objective is to minimize the loss function. Okay, and we have seen some hyperparameters. Like hyperparameters are basically your configuration settings. Like you may change them, and you may see what is the change on your outcome or your output. And according to that, you may do changes on your settings as well. Okay, and at last, you have seen some workflow like data pre-processing. Okay, in data pre-processing, we have data cleaning, scaling values. Like we have seen 1 kg, 1 gram, or sorry, 1000 gram. Okay, so we have to take them in one scale. Like we will run a, for example, a Python if statement, and we will check if any row, okay, if any particular value of that row contains kg in that. For let's take an example of measurements. Okay, suppose say we want to scale the value for your measurements. Okay, so then we will run a for loop, sorry, if statement. If there if the element contains kg, okay. Suppose for now we are scaling the all values in grams. Okay, so then we want that if the weight is in kg, then we want to multiply this value with 1000, this one. So a new column in our a new data set, our scaled value will look something like this, 1000, because that was 1 kg, right? And for other values, suppose say it was 1.5 kg, it was 1000 gram. Okay, so it will find that if the state, if the element contains, if the record contains kg, then you have to multiply 1000 in it. Okay, if that does not if the kg is not in there, so you have to leave it, or you have to not perform any computation. So that's so that is the case where we can convert all the entries into grams. So now your all the entries will be in your grams, like 1000, 1500, and 1000 gram. Now if you will perform any computation in it, so all are in grams, right? So there will be no accuracy loss, or your model will get accurate data, kind of. Okay, because what if some values are in kg, some are in grams, right? You may understand that it will have some conflict here, right? To avoid those conflicts, we are converting all the data in one scale. Okay, Similarly, we have encoding methods, like we have discussed one hot encoding and ordinal encoding, right? And then we are training your model. Now in training your model, whenever we talk with like of machine learning, right? Like basically most of the time we are talking about this training of our model. Like most of the people think that a major task is to train your model, right? But it is not. If you have if you would have spent some days on machine learning, you would be knowing that in training your model is not that hard or not that difficult, right? Here you just have to feed your pre-processed data into your already written algorithms or your already written code, right? The main task is here, data pre-processing, because this was your raw data according to your use case or whatever you got as while collecting your data. Here you perform all these steps, like cleaning data, scaling data, encoding the values, right? And once after performing all these operations, then you get a clean data or the data that is fit for your training your model, right? Then you can perform, then you can give that data to your algorithms. Then you can adjust the model model's performance, right? Yes. And after that, you can optimize your model's performance at this point, at this training your model optimize your algorithm, right? By adjusting the hyperparameters. Like here we discussed about hyperparameters, right? This. Now what you will do is you will adjust them. If your model is not trained well or do not give accuracy as you want, now you will come at this point again, this hyperparameter, right? You will set, you will change this value, you will change this learning rate, okay? Earlier you have suppose some value, now you will change that value and see if your error of your model improves or not, okay? By model improves, what I mean accuracy increase or not. Okay, so this can be done by your hyperparameter tuning or adjusting your hyperparameters. Adjusting. Can are you able to understand my writing or is it having some problems because I'm writing just because
good,
because actually the screen size is different. I'm writing on pen, so it is like writing in air kind of thing.
No, it's fine. I'm taking a printout. It came out nice. It's no worries.
Okay, so I will try to make it adjusted properly. Okay, so then after training, see, while the workflow, you have kind of four important things. Like first of all, you have to process your data. Then you have to train your model. Then you have to evaluate. Then you have to check whether your output given by your model is related to your true model or true data or original data, your predicted value, right? Then that will help you to evaluate your model, right? And at the last, we have fine tuning, or you may say optimization. Okay, so the third step is your evaluation. In this evaluation, again you get some 2 points, right? The first is your testing. In your testing, you assess the model's performance on unseen data. This was your unseen data, right? What was your unseen data? If you can remember, this training set was our unseen data. Okay. Training set was the data that we have given to our model, so that it may learn, right? And we have separated the 30% of our data, right? So that now we will evaluate it according to that 30% of the data. We will see with that data whether my output is, whether my output match with that data or not, because that is your unseen data. We haven't feed that data to our model yet, okay? So we will assess the model's performance on that unseen data, basically, okay? And then we have some metrics for your evaluating. Like you may learn about them in depth, like they are basically your accuracy. Some like accuracy is one way of evaluating your model. Okay, so another way is your precision. How precise your model? Like some people might want accurate their model to be evaluated on the basis of their accuracy, and some may want to evaluate their model or their machine learning model on the basis of this precision. How precise do the value are the output are, right? The predictions are, and there are some other terms as well, like recall, F1 score. For F1 score is basically used for your classification. Okay, you may read about some articles about them, and you have your mean squared error. Like most of the time, we use mean squared error, or RMSE sometimes. Relative mean squared error. Okay. What here we do? Where we basically we try to figure out. We take the mean. First of all, let me tell you how it works. Basically, how the evaluation works. Suppose you have your true value, right? True value, your predicted value. Predicted value. I may do some math wrong, but just take the idea of how it is done. Okay, so suppose say your true value is 10.1. Suppose like this might be your price of your house in lakhs. Okay, lakh is your Indian currency. Like suppose say for example, this value is on your 100K. This 100K. Okay, also suppose a million. Suppose a million. Okay. This million, 10.1 million. Okay, suppose your true output value for your house number 1 is 10.1. Okay, and my model predicted that this house should be around 9 million. Okay, so now if you see what is the error here, error is your true minus your predicted value. It will be your 1.1, right? And for the second value, suppose say my true value was 11, and it also predicted 11. So here the error was zero,
No.
no error. So on the third, similarly, it take the true value was suppose say 8 million, and my model predicted it to be 12. Now here is a huge error. It is the error is of 4. Okay. So in RMSE, so how we will decide our accuracy or how accurate our model is, basically how we'll evaluate the models, right? Is our model good or wrong? So what we will do is we will mean it. We will try to see the average of it. Okay, and why we square it? Why we say mean squared error, right? Mean squared error. Why we do square of them? Because suppose say you have another value. It is like your 12. And your predicted value is your 8, okay? And what we are doing is we are true minus predicted, right? Sorry, true minus predicted. Yes. So here we are doing true minus predicted. So this value should be your in minus, right? We are doing true minus predicted. So this is 8 minus 12, right? So this should be minus 4, okay?
4.
So what here it is, the problem here comes is this value is cancelling this value, right? Means it will be subtracting values, right? So to solve this problem, that's why we are squaring these value. We will square all the value and then we will find the mean. So while we squaring this value, it will become 16 and this will also become 16. This will not cancel it basically. Right, right. Okay. So this will not cancel it basically. So that's why we are doing square, and then we will find the mean of this value, and therefore we will get any value, and it should be minimum. We will try to minimize it, right? Here we have seen our motive, our objective is to minimize the loss function. Okay, so these are your loss functions, metrics, accuracy, precision, recall, F1 score, mean squared error, right? So this is your third step after training your model. Okay, and now your fourth step comes, that is your fine tuning. Fine tuning and optimization. Okay. And now in this topic, in this step, what we do? We basically, if our accuracy is low, we will change the hyperparameter, or we'll say we do hyperparameter tuning. Okay. Hyperparameter tuning. Okay. In this step, basically we iteratively adjust hyperparameters, right? We do iteratively. Like suppose say in your mind, or your, if you find any by through your domain knowledge, or while you perform some statistical methods, you find some values like you find some value like 1.0. Either this value may perform well, or either this value may perform well, or either this value may perform well, and suppose you have some more values like this. Okay, so what in this step you will do is you will change this value. Suppose say for first step you took some value, okay, and now that if you want to change that value, and if you want to compare that value with some other hyperparameters, so you will do it iteratively. You will change that value and you will perform some iterations, and then you will see whether the accuracies or the evaluation matrix is changing or not. It is basically to optimize your performance. Okay, and that at last we come at model selection, and that will wind your workflow. Okay, and at this point now we can select our model by seeing the data or by doing the trial and test. Okay, and this will wind your workflow of your machine learning model. Okay, data preparation, data preprocessing, training your model, evaluation and fine tuning. Okay, now comes the more interesting part, that is your applications. Okay, where you are, where the basically your machine learning can be applied. Okay, so can you try to tell some areas where you have seen the applications of machine learning? Yes, you may try to means like think of any particular field, and then we will discuss where the machine learning is applied on that particular field.
Yeah, I'm thinking in the pharma side.
Yes, in healthcare, yeah. Basically, where say, yeah.
No, pharma. Yeah, healthcare. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Life science.
Yeah.
I was working as a data in life science.
Don't tell in depth, just tell the overview. Like in healthcare we can use it for you can use it for like predicting disease, right? You will be seeing some images and on the basis of the images you will see some spots, like the spots and the pattern, like this pattern of skin may lead to some kind of disease, right? Therefore, you may use it for like predicting disease, even before it shows symptoms, right? Like on atom level, atoms are showing some pattern, right? Then you may, at the starting of that particular disease, or suppose say cancer, at that point only you may figure out that there are some chances of that particular person may getting that disease, right? Like in healthcare also you can do some personalized medicine, like personalized medicine on the basis of person's physique or person's like body, whatever the height or weight ratio, right? Like on the basis of these things, like you may give some personalized medicine. Okay, so these might be the healthcare applications. Like nowadays you may have seen the smartwatch we are having, right? In that smartwatch, we are having the health, the heartbeat tracker, right? So that can be a major your application of that. Like it is tracking your healthcare, right? On the daily basis. Therefore, it is what it is doing is it is taking the data, it is collecting data at the core, okay? And then if you have the proper skill, then you can use that data to predict or to know more about your health. You will see do I am getting the heartbeat increase or decrease or whatever, are you seeing any pattern there, right? And if there is any pattern, like it is decreasing at any certain point, and if you are able to analyze that data basically, then it can be helpful for you on the basic, okay? And then some other applications like you can use in any level, like you can use in finance also, right? How in finance? Like in fraud detection. Like to take an example for your finance, we can use it for your fraud detection, right? Like earlier what happened, earlier what used to happen, like on Gmail only we used to get OTPs, right? Even today we are getting OTPs and links, and it is saying urgent, and it is containing some words like urgent, pay now, or these words, right? So what there exactly there we are using this machine learning. So in the using this machine learning, we are using the technique that I discussed, that NLP, natural language processing. So it is helping us to helping our model to know what the text is. Like if you it finds that in that I think showed you that sentiment analysis, right? We have talked about that sentiment analysis. Yeah, so it will basically try to analyze the sentiment of that particular message, right? If I message you something on the Gmail, it's analyze that sentiment, whether the I'm in urgent, I'm talking about money or these things, right? If I am, then it will be putting me in a spam category. And like your in finance, we can use in like in your stock market prediction, whether the stock will increase or decrease. Like in high frequency trading, and these are the some interesting stuff. In retail, you have customer segmentation, right? You have to segment customer. Like you have to segment customer with different choices, the customer with sub choices, so that you may just so like suppose say if what how Amazon works, right? Suppose say you purchased car. Or suppose sorry, if you purchase any product, a smartphone, right? It will put you in a category of the person who have earlier purchased the smartphone, and it will try to see what other product that person have purchased. Suppose the earphone. Now you are categorized into that person category, right? This is your customer segmentation. Okay, so it will also show you the earphone and the other related products like cover. So you are basically segmented to that particular segment, or particular to that particular customer segmentation, right? And at the same time, it will also help you to demand forecast. Okay, so now let's wrap up this topic. It is taking more longer. Let me just explain you quickly. Okay, so in retail, you have customer segmentation, demand forecasting, right? In natural language processing, you may use it for chatbots, okay? Sentiment analysis, and for computer vision, okay? So similar to NLP, NLP is your for basically your for your textual models, right? Your computer vision works for your image thing, right? Computer vision is for your image. Image machine learning models, okay? So using this, you can recognize an image, like you can recognize a person or recognize any object like dog, table, cat, or anything, okay? And you have another application like automation, sorry, autonomous vehicle. Autonomous vehicle, like in your Tesla, you have seen, right? So they are using basically the technology of this, like path planning and object recognition, okay? So these are basically your applications so that you can do after using these using these techniques. Okay. Now let's start with the taking an example that is of your house price prediction basically. In that, what we will do is, let me take the data set here. Okay, so this is your data set. This is your from your USA housing.csv. Okay, so any doubt till here, confusion or any questions? Okay, so this data set contains some rows, columns. Okay, so these columns are basically your average area income. Okay, this is basically that a average of that area income and the average area house. Okay, house age, like how old that age was particular basically. Okay, I think in readme we would be having we have about that and data sheet. Yes. Okay, so here you may see that in a average area income, we have average income of the householder of the city house that is located in. Okay, and in average area house age, we are having the average age of the house in the same city. Okay, and average area number of rooms, we are having the average number of rooms for the houses in the same city. Okay, and similarly, we are having the average bedroom number of bedroom of our house. So we are having the main thing is the area, number of bedrooms, number of rooms, and your population of that city and the price. Okay, so this will be our target value. Okay, and we have the address of the house. So this will be our target value. Okay, you may say this is label. Okay, and these will be all your features. Using these things, we will try to predict this price. Okay, these are your independent variables. This can be anything, like this value can be anything. This is independent. It don't depend on any other values, right? This may not be any specific value. This can be anything, 5, 6, 7. It may range some between some numbers, but it is actually the independent variable, right? This is independent, but this price actually depends on these value. If this will increase, this might also increase if it is positively correlated. Okay, so now we will try to see this. Since this is a simple one, because you may see the most of the values are scaled, like here you see all the values are on a same range, right? A single decimal point, and there are no null values, no missing values, no duplicate entries. Okay, so this will be a simple use case. Just we will be putting the data and we will be seeing. Okay, and this column is basically your address, and it will be not be helpful. Okay, we will be basically most of the time we will be dropping this or delete or removing this data. Okay, this address, we just want these five columns, and on the basis of this we will try to predict our price. Okay, so now let's see the PYNB file, IPYNB file, that is your basically a Jupyter notebook. So in this, yes, so first for the starting I was thinking to write on the live, but it will take more time, so that's why I'm using the pre-written code. Okay, so it will basically I have to just explain you. Okay, so as I have already told you, the four basic libraries that we use, right, that we are importing: pandas for your data manipulation, numpy mathematical computation, seaborn and matplotlib for your visualization. Okay, here we are just using the data read underscore csv for reading our data set. Okay, using the head we are displaying the first five rows of our data. Okay, so these are your first five: average income, average area, average a number of rooms, average number of bedrooms, area population, this is the population of that particular area, price, okay, and your address. Now if you will see the info, it will give you the info. Basically these are the float values, this all are the float values. Last is your categorical variable, right? So since this is all are numerical, so you don't have to do any changes to them, okay? So whenever you see a data set, this is your first job, is to see how many numerical variables are there and how many categorical variables are there, okay? Once you see that, then you will get a basically you overview of if you have any categorical data, that how you will convert that into numerical variable, or if it is not important, you can drop it, okay? So now all are the numerical variable, we don't have to do much, okay? Now we will use a describe function, so it will basically help you to see, give you the overview of every row, sorry, every column, okay? So it will give you the count, how many count values are there. So using this count, it will help you to basically find the missing values. If there are any missing values, it will be telling you. It will be less than the total number of rows, okay? So since all are the 5000, there are no missing values. This the mean will be giving you the mean of the this, right, for the every column. Standard deviation will be your, it will be giving you the standard deviation for your every column, okay? Similarly for your minimum value, 25 percentile, 50 percentile, 75 percentile, and your max, okay? Remember where you were using this percentile concept at the time of our box plot, or basically finding the outliers, right? We were multiplying 1.5 to our IQR, interquartile range, and our interquartile range was our this minus the quartile third minus quartile one, so that was our interquartile range, right? And using that, we were finding the lower bound and upper bound. So this concept, this basic thing is helpful there, right? Now using this columns and dot columns, we are just seeing how many columns are there, what is the name of that column, okay? So these are the name of the column, okay? And now here we are doing some basic exploratory data analysis, okay? Why I'm saying basic? Because here we are just taking that data set and just plotting. We are not doing any other changes on the data. We are not manipulating our data. What basically happens is, what normally happens is, we change some value. Like here you are having area population. What we will do in normal scenario or real world scenario, we will segment them. Suppose say area population, we will make houses with a area population some points like 0 to 25 at one category, right? Basically we will try to find if we can do any, make it so the basic main aim will be our main aim will be to get more and more insights if possible, okay? So we will be seeing that on our later sessions, that complex part. So for now, just we are using the simple stuff as it is. We are using the data set as it is, okay? So this was our house DF. So we have used this as it is, and we have used the SNS, our seaborn library, and inside that we have used our pair plot method function, okay? And we are giving this data set to it, okay? This house DF. So now on the basis of every column, it have plotted some graphs, okay? It have drawn this average area income, this corresponding to average area income, and it looks something like this, okay? Basically this is your graph. Yeah please say.
So each column it shows, right?
Yes.
So this is average income, this, what is the next one, it's mean or what?
This is your average house age corresponding to your average area income. So like this we are getting the in the corresponding value, like on the x-axis we have this values, on the y-axis we have, if we have this value, so this graph will be plotted, this graph.
Yes.
Okay, So these are the basically here we are not getting any insights because here we are just giving the data as it is. Okay. So and since these are just some numbers, like not much, but so therefore we are not seeing some more insights. Okay. So we will be yeah. So if you want to plot a distribution plot, okay. So what is a distribution plot? Basically, it is your probability function. Okay. So like it will help you to find the probability of your values. Like how many people lie the price of the houses are between this value and this value, okay? So this will be your probability. If you will add these values up, you will this value will be equals to 1. If you will multiply this value with this value, this value with this value, and similarly you will multiply this value with this this x-axis with y-axis and add them up, it will give you the value that equals to 1. Okay, so this is how your dist plot basically works. Okay, so this is a distribution of how your data is plotted, like how your houses with price between 10k sorry 1000k or 1 million I guess 1 million and 1.5 million like okay. So the most of the house are lie between this, or you may say like the since this is a normal distribution. Okay, so in normal distribution we have a rule that 69% of your data will lie between first quartile and your second quartile, sorry, first standard deviation and your second standard deviation. Okay, so standard deviation we have figured out here, STD, right? This
yes,
for
yes.
Population it was this value. Sorry, yeah,
yes.
Yeah, this value, right? So if you can learn about more it, if I found a value here, empirical rule for your empirical rule for distribute normal distribution. So it will give you exactly how it is helpful. Like 68% of the value between the first standard deviation and your second negative standard deviation and your positive standard deviation, right? This value and this value. Okay, so
okay.
The 68% of your data basically lies between here, and 75% of your data lies between this and this, like you have minus seven minus second deviation standard deviation plus second deviation. Okay, and 99.7% of your data will lie between this positive three standard deviation and negative three standard deviation. That's why most of the time we try to fit our data into normal distribution. Okay, so we have once we perform this all EDA thing, so here we are not doing exactly what the EDA is. Here we're just we are just we are showing you the graphs. Okay, we will actually see the EDA in the further upcoming video of your further upcoming lectures. Okay, when you will be using a flight approach, the flight price prediction. Okay, so it is a little bit complex, but it will be more interesting. Okay, then now your workflow comes. Now once you have load the data set, okay, yes, so now it's your training your training part. Okay, now here what we are doing is here we are separating our data. Okay, once you have pre-processed your data, okay, till this point you have pre-processed our data. Okay, so now here we are training our data set. Okay, so enough in the training data set, what was the first part? Can you tell what was the first part in the process of training data set?
We have to label the data, x-axis or y-axis.
Yes. Wait a second. Okay. So that our data pre-processing is completed, okay? Why data pre-processing is completed? Because in the data pre-processing step, what we do is we clean our data, we scale our data, we encode our data, okay? So that is not needed, okay? So that's why our this first step is completed, okay? So now we are on this second step, that is our training our model, okay? In our training our model, we use some learning algorithm, okay? And then we will try to optimize it, okay? Now we are in the second step, that is our training our model. Okay, in the training step, first step is to separate our data, like in our independent variables and our dependent variables.
Oh, that is a flag word. Okay.
Yeah,
Independent.
features and labels. Okay, so here we are doing that. Okay, and once you have divided your data into your features and labels, now we will split them on our 80-20 ratio or 70-30 ratio, whatever you want, okay? So that we can use the majority part for our training purpose and the rest for our evaluating it, okay? Evaluating the accuracy or the metrics, okay? Now we will split our data into that basically a ratio, okay? So for doing that, we have a pre-written code that will help us. Okay, so that is your train and test split. Okay, in the train and test, you have to specify what is the ratio. Here we are doing 60-40 ratio. Okay, 0.4. So the test size will be your 40%. Okay, and it will return some value like x train, x test, y train, y test. On the x, we are having the features or the independent variables, and on y, we are having our dependent variables. Okay, and for the training we'll be having the 60% 60% and test 40% 40%. Okay, once this completed, then we can